Hello viewers, and welcome back to another episode of Let Supreme Ghost Thief. As you see today, I have decided to try the Dark mod. Or not try it, I have tried it before, but I haven't played any other missions than the mission I'm going to try today, called the Training Mission. So it's basically the introductory mission made with the release of the Dark mod. For those of you not familiar with the Dark mod, I'm not going to go through too much of what it really is. I mean, it's easy to research that on your own. But it basically is a total conversion mod, originally made for Doom 3, but now it's been made standalone. As you can see, this is version 2.02, and it's the latest release as I'm recording this. The Dark mod, of course, is a recreation of the Thief games, where the entire gameplay is trying to replicate as much as possible the original Thief games. And that, of course, is why I like it and why I want to show you this, because I'm a big, big fan of the original Thief games. That is Thief Gold and Thief 2. So we're going to delve right into this. I just want to show you guys first that I am playing on hardcore difficulty, both for AI vision and hearing, expert for lockpicking, and expert for combat difficulty. And I've disabled the auto parry. So that's the only place in the mission besides choosing the objectives where you can change your difficulty level. So I want to go ahead. I've already installed the training mission. So let me see. There. This is a training mission in which to practice skills needed in the Dark mod. And you can see that this is a whole team effort from the Dark mod team. And in the notes it says that this map is a training mission in which to practice skills needed in the Dark mod, as I just said. To coincide with the release of the Dark mod 1.08 update, Bikerdude went about giving the old training mission a complete overhaul. Many of the original mapping methods have been replaced with contemporary techniques and a lot of new eye candy. Sounds good. Let's go ahead and give this a go. The Dark Mod Trainer Mission. This trainer gives you the opportunity to practice skills needed in the Dark Mod before you use them in actual missions. Even if you are familiar with stealth gaming, you should still learn features unique to the Dark Mod, including its special lockpicking method, fine object manipulation, flexible climbing, and combat. There's also special equipment to master, rope, moss, and water arrows, flash bombs, a spyglass, and more. Explore and experiment freely to find how things work. There are also helpful guide messages, but they do not force you in any direction. To exit, just press escape to quit the mission. You can return whenever you want to practice any section. So if we click on objectives, you notice that there are no difficulty settings. It's all just trainer. And the only objective says there are no formal objectives nor difficulty levels in this trainer mission. Use quit mission on the main menu to finish. Now, for those of you familiar with my videos, and also for those of you that are not familiar, I play with the original Supreme Ghost rules that was made back in the early 2000s for Thief 1 and 2. And I'm going to try to implement those as much as I can in the Dark mod. Now, there has not been made an official rule set for Ghost or Supreme Ghost for this mod. If anyone is interested in making that or helping out making it, I suggest that not a brand new rule set is made, but more an amendment to the original rules that that will interact well with the Dark mod. There are a few things that are different, but most things, since it is a conversion from the old Thief games, are pretty similar. So many of the, most of the rules actually can be used. So in this mission I am going to use all the original rules from the Supreme Ghost mode, and if you guys want to look at those rules, you can see in the video description below. Now, because there are no objectives here, I will follow the in-game instructions given in books, notes, scrolls, or even in the pop-up messages that come on screen. Which means that if an instruction is given there that would normally bust a Supreme Rule or Supreme Ghost, I will count that as an objective, and therefore it will not bust Ghost. So that will come into play on a couple of occasions in this mission. That is the only way I can make this mission a fair playthrough, because obviously there's going to be many times where we are having to bust Ghost. Also, we cannot finish this mission in any way. There's no real, you know, ending of the mission. It's just a practice mission. So I'm going to do everything that is meant to be done, go through all the sections, and try to find all the loot, and then just stop the video. So there won't be the common, the stat screen or the post-mission screen that you usually get when you finish a mission. I don't really know what that stat screen looks like because I haven't finished any other mission but this trainer, but I'm planning on doing that in the upcoming weeks and months. Now, also, since we don't get a stat screen at the end, I don't know the maximum amount of loot that you can find in this mission. I have found a total of 3513, I think, just over 3,500. That will also be described in the video description if you want to see that right now. I can't exactly remember. And I'll show you everything that I've found, but if any of you guys out there, any of you, you viewers, have found more than that, or if you found other pieces of loot that you see I miss, please let me know. Or if you, for some reason, know the maximum loot. I'm sure there's a way to go into the mission files and actually look at the max loot. I don't know how to do that because I'm not a mission editor. But if any of you do, please let me know how, or let me know the total loot amount so that I can feel content if I found all of it, or I can actually keep looking for more. We'll go ahead and start, and then there are a few more things that I'll talk about once we get going. Okay, welcome to the Dark Mod training mission. Read the book on the desk for your instructions. When the book is highlighted, press FROB. Alright, so here we are. Two things to begin with. First of all, this mission is possible to Supreme Ghosts, at least following the interpretation of the rules that I have made. There's especially one area, which I'm going to do very, very end of the mission, the last section I'm going to go into, the stealth area. That includes one thing that, you know, you can possibly solve it in two ways, and I'll show you both ways, and then you be the judge of which one is the better. But it is possible to Supreme Ghost nonetheless. Whichever way we do it, one of them will definitely be a Supreme Ghost success. And I'll talk a little bit more about that once I get into the stealth area, but the second thing I wanted to mention was that enemies' alert levels are a little bit different. Especially, some enemies can have alert levels where they turn their heads and look at you, or look towards you, without actually saying anything. The original rules mention comments, first alerts, as being a bust to Supreme. So, I'm not 100% sure yet how I will interpret that, but I don't think that I will end up counting head turning as a bust to Supreme. To me, that's not enough to actually trigger a first alert. If it's not worth mentioning to the guards, it's not really detection level that would constitute a bust to me. But again, anyone who has comments on the Supreme rules or Ghost rules in general for this mod, please chime in the comments. I would love to hear your opinions. Maybe I'll even start a discussion on it in my channel, who knows. So anyway, let's go ahead and get going here. Welcome to the Dark Mod. In this training mission, you will learn how to fight, open locks, manipulate objects, and other skills that you will need to play Dark Mod missions. Each of the doors in this room leads to a specific training area. You can choose which skills to practice and may quit the map at any time. Messages will appear on your screen to guide you. They can be turned off in the menu if you wish. If you are new to stealth gaming, you should probably try all training areas. All players should use the Gamma Room and at least try the combat and lockpicking sections, as both work quite differently from other stealth games you may be familiar with. Hit your next weapon key to turn the page. Readables, books, letters, etc., usually have important clues. If you notice a bent corner or a large roll for scrolls, it means you can use the next or previous weapon keys to flip the page. Hitting the attack or use key puts the book away. Note that the game does not pause while reading, so be careful. That's an important note, so it means that guards can see you and actually attack you in real time as you're reading, which is more realistic, of course. So, in addition to hitting attack or use, you can also just walk away from the book like this, and you will not read it anymore. So, what I'm going to start with is actually show you the gamma and brightness room. If you've played this game before and played the training mission, I don't imagine it being very interesting for you to look at, so I'm going to annotate so you can skip that room and move on to the keys and lockpick, which is the one I'm going to do first. So here's the gamma and brightness. Behind this door, you'll find instructions on how to set your gamma and brightness correctly. Read the book on the desk for instructions. Okay. Gamma and brightness. The gamma and brightness settings are in the video settings menu. The gamma slider adjusts the mid-range brightness the most and less towards top and bottom, which are anchored. The brightness slider effectively adjusts the contrast. To see if they are set correctly, there are three small tests you can perform. While this book is showing, turn the gamma or the menu gamma and brightness sliders all the way down, and then slowly turn up brightness. Keep checking how this book looks. You ought to see not only the text clearly, but the grubby texture of the pages themselves. As you turn up the brightness, that rich texture detail would gradually disappear, so stop just below that. So I have already done all this. So I am now using the gamma and brightness settings that fits for me. That depends a lot on your monitor, on your video card, on the lighting in the room that you're sitting in, and probably a few other things as well. So my background now of this book looks exactly like they've described. It's not too bright, it's not too dark, but I can see the texture of it. So I suggest that you guys find that setting as well. If the contrast in this book is too harsh, then turn down the brightness slider and possibly turn up the gamma until it looks right and you can see detail in the paper texture. If the book looks washed out and faded, then turn up the brightness slider and then possibly turn down the gamma until it looks right. Now slowly turn up the gamma slider to a comfortable level. Make sure no page background details is lost, and no part of a page should be widened, maxed out. This page should be a light cream at its brightest. If you see white, then your settings are too bright. Now go to the small window in this room. Press close up to it and look straight ahead. The far wall is divided into three sections. Adjust your settings so the middle section letters are only just detectable, but probably unreadable. This depends on your monitor. Recheck the book to get the best compromise, but the game environment is more, and this sentence has been cut off somehow, so maybe it's supposed to say more important, I'm not sure. So let's go ahead and do that right away. So if we walk over to this window, so I can see and read the right section back there. I can see the middle section that there are letters, but I can't really read it. And the section on the left, I cannot see at all. It just looks like a black wall to me. So that's how it's supposed to be. Now check out the floor in this room. Go to a corner away from the torch and crouch. You should just be able to see a little detail in the dark cobbled floor. It should not be totally black. Ideally now, FM makers and players are seeing the same thing. So if you see a bright room or a dark alley, then that is how the author intended it. Okay, let's do that. Walk over to this corner. And when I see down now, I can see that the floor is green, but I can't make out much detail. I can see the outline of the bricks, but that's pretty much it. So that's how it should be. So I would suggest you make these tests on your own, because this game obviously is about atmosphere, and lighting is a big part of it, as you can see. Okay, so we're going to go to keys and lock picking next, which is over here. Behind this door, you can practice using keys and lock picks. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and make a save. Save one. I'm also going to make a quick save. Right there. You can find lockpicks in the locked chest. Pick up the key from the table and press use or frob on the chest with the key selected in your inventory. So we're going to pick this up. Acquired chest key. Okay. We're going to open it up. You saw a little green flash there on the chest key. That means that we unlocked something. And we can open that. Good. Now read the book for instructions on how to pick locks and move on to the next room to start practicing. So here we have triangle lockpick and we have snake lockpick. Okay. Let's go ahead and that was the wrong one. Oh yeah, of course, because I'm not using the key. There. So now I relocked the chest. Since I'm playing Supreme, I have to relock everything and I have to replace everything. Now, replacing of objects is much, much easier in the Dark mod than it is in other. In the original Thief games. So you can place things back exactly the way you found it, like that, which I think is very cool. Because that means that you can eliminate any kind of visible sign that you were there, which is really what Supreme Ghost is all about. Okay, lockpicking. Mastery of your lockpicks is essential if you are to complete the many missions that await you. In the next room are doors for you to practice on. For each open door, there is a key to lock it if you wish to pick it again. There are two types of lockpicks, triangle and snake. To begin, you must have the correct lockpick selected in inventory. If you do not, you will see a red flash behind the lockpick icon. To pick a lock, move close enough to highlight the door and hold the use key. You will start to hear a sequence of clicks and see the door handle or lock pin jiggle and sink. The clicks are random pattern. At the end of the pattern is a brief period of silence, then the pattern will begin again. To be successful, you must release the use key or hit the attack key at the start of that silence. If you hit the attack key at the wrong time, there is a dull fail sound and the pattern begins again. Your goal is to learn the sequence of clicks so that you can anticipate when it will end. Some locks are more difficult than others and have multiple pins, which may require switching lockpicks. You can make lockpicking harder or easier in the settings menu by adjusting how much silence there is between each pattern. The more silence, the easier it is to react in time. Setting lockpicking to auto will make locks open automatically after the pattern repeats 3 times. Okay. So, just to warn you guys, I am not very good at the lockpicking still, even though I've played this mission like twice now. So bear with me if this takes a little bit longer than what it does for you, or maybe longer than it should. This door is easy to pick. It has one tumbler. Okay. So that was the wrong lockpick. You heard that click there. So we got to use the triangle. Okay, I got it open on the first one. But that is an easy one. Okay, so in here we have a single statue worth 150 gold. And we also have the first bar door key. Since this is Supreme, we have to relock this door. And all you need to do then is use the key on the door again. Like that. No, you do not. You have to use the interact key afterwards. There we go. So now it's locked again. But now we have to replace the key. So we have to throw that key back. Which I think you can do by holding it in front of you and then pressing the attack button. That means that you will throw the item. But I'm going to quick save until I get this right. There we go. That's good enough. As long as it's on that little section to the right of the plate. There. This door is slightly more difficult than the first. It has 2 tumblers. Okay, let's go ahead and give that a try. So again, start with the triangle. Okay. There, we got it. There we go. So yeah, I told you guys I'm not very good at this. Hopefully I'll get better. So we have a lion statue in here worth 175. And we have two stacks of coins worth 2 each. Excuse me. And of course we have the second barred door key. So you can, even though the door is open, you can press interact like that and it will lock as you close it. And again, we have to then throw this key back. This key was on the left-hand side this time. Oops. There, hold that in front of us. So you can manipulate the objects in the air, which I think is cool. No, I don't want to lie on the plate like that. There we go. That's just my OCD side coming out. So that's why I like Supreme Ghost, I guess. This store is a tough one. It has 3 tumblers. Okay. So the snake we start with. Man, I always let go too early. There we go, finally. Okay, better. Okay, this third cage, you have 2 vases worth 75 each and a gold plate worth 35, total 514. Then we have the third barred door key. Notice that in the dark mod you can't lock block the doors. Remember in Thief, if you ever did this, you could lock the door and then block it. And then, regardless of whether you opened or closed it after that point, it was still locked. But that doesn't happen in the dark mod. The benefit of doing that in the old Thief games was that you could leave the key inside, close the door, and it was locked. But if I close the door right now, it's open. So I have to actually wait for the door to close before it is locked. Like that. So, let me go ahead and place this one back. There we go, good. This door is the most difficult to pick, but the reward is the greatest. It has 4 tumblers. All right. That was a difficult one. Okay. And the last one. Good. Okay. So, in this room, we have one statue worth 150. We have two vases worth 75 each. We have a purse that should be worth 50. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 coins that are each worth 1. And we have the treasure room key. I guess this is the treasure room. Now we get to a difficult part, because what we have to do, we can't throw the key through the bars, because this is a solid door. But we still have to lock it for Supreme, if we want the gold in there, which obviously I do. So what I have to do now is, what you can do, is you can click interact with the key on this door, and then toss it while the door is closing. If the door closes, then even after you let go of the key, it will still lock. So that's what I'm going to do right now. I'm going to try to do this as effectively as I can. Okay, that did not work. I wasn't ready for that. I don't know if this will work. Oh, let's see. Okay, that won't work. This is a little tricky. Okay, so I'm not sure if I got it to work now. So what I'm going to do is that I'm gonna save, quick save, and then pick the lock again and see if everything is good in there. If it is, I can just reload. So if you want to skip this door, be my guest. Man, this is difficult. I guess it's on expert, so. Good. Okay. Okay, so this key was on the floor, so that is not a good throw. So then I have to do it again. So again, I will annotate if, or you probably would have seen the annotation already if this takes longer, which it seems like it's doing. Okay. That didn't sound really like it was a good throw. Let me see if I can, oh. Oh no, that was a bad choice. Okay. I get some lockpicking practice anyway. Luckily, not many doors in the world of the Dark Mod is this difficult to pick. And now I'm getting a little bit more hang of it, which I think I needed. There we go. So what I did, I reloaded instead of saving. just my bad. Okay, so I'm gonna try a few times. Okay, so if I hit the, so I have to stand here, right? Yeah. Okay, so if I hit the right wall first, I think that's the key. All right, I'm gonna try once more. Yeah, if I hit the right wall instead of hitting the left wall first, I think there's a bigger chance. Let me see if... yeah, that would be acceptable too. The physics of items is so different in this game than in Thief. That sounded like it was good, because I didn't hear the cling when it fell on the floor. So now I'm going to test this out. I saved, so I'm going to... Man. There must be so many of you viewers now that are so frustrated with me not being able to get this. I'm sorry. You do have the option to skip it, so please do. I will not blame you. No, I do not. There, okay. There, good. So now I can reload and I know that the key is on the back ledge. Good. Now in the next room, there's going to be a safe that I think also has four tumblers. And there's going to be a machine room on the right. The point of the mission, or the point of this section, is for you to unlock the gate of the machine room and then shut off the machine so that you can hear the tumblers in the safe. I'm not going to do that because you can't turn the machine back on afterwards without leaving the door open. Well, you can. No, you can't return the key properly because that hangs on the wall there. You have to leave it on the floor instead. I think that's okay if you want to do that. But I can hear the safe, so I rather want to open the safe directly. So this might be a little bit noisy. The wall safe gives no visual cue while lockpicking, and you can't hear its clicks if there's noise. Lockpick the boarded door, and I didn't read the rest. But here you have it. You're supposed to lockpick this, get the key, or get the key if you want to try to lockpick it again. And this note says, warning, danger from moving parts. can turn the machine off and therefore hear the safe. Got the first one. The last one should be coming now. Great. In here we have a large trophy worth 250, and we have two gold goblets worth 15 each. That's it. And we have the safe key. So again, what we have to do now is lock it and then throw the safe key back in before it closes. There we go. Good. So now we have 1151 in loot. So now we're ready to handle the next area. There was no door here, right? And we can't return the lockpicks. Can't drop them. And everything is done in there. Good. So I want to go to jumping and climbing. In the area behind this door, you can practice jumping and climbing. And this area will be a little bit more, I guess, interesting exploration. Use crouch to go through the hole in the wall. There we go. To get over obstacles, stand close, then hold down mantle or jump for a second. If it does not work the first time, then adjust your position. So, mantling is one movement type that works a lot better in this game, at least compared to the original Thief games. New Mantle with the new Dark updates have made mantling a lot better in Thief and Thief 2. Let me go ahead and make a real save here. Save 2. And here's a little mini side quest that I'm going to do. There are actually sort of an objective, at least it comes up as an objective when you take the first healing potion, to get 10 of them. So that's what I'm going to do, and the first one is down here. 10 health potions are hidden in both halves of this section. Use your just learned skills to find them all. Okay, good. And since we're playing Supreme, we have to return these. So I'm just going to go ahead and return this one right away. You will still get the credit for them. There we go. It's the first one. The second one is in that window, and we have to use a crate. See the open window? Stack some small crates and climb on them to reach the window. Of course, we have to return the crate afterwards. There. There we go. Okay. You found 2 health potions, 8 to go. Place that back neatly on the shelf. That's what I think is cool. You can replace everything. In here are two pieces of loot. There is a vase here worth 75 and a gold plate worth 35. I haven't found anything else in here. Again, if you have, please let me know. So let's replace this crate next then. There we go. Okay. The third healing potion is found right over here, under this staircase. Right here. So if you want to stretch or extend or make the item go closer to you, all you need to do is use the mouse wheels. Or a next previous weapon. But that's defaulted as mouse wheel up and down. So that was three. The fourth one. Move or jump towards the ladder to attach yourself to it. Move or jump away from the ladder to detach. Move up here like that. To mantle onto a high ledge, look at the ledge and hold jump to pull yourself up. Okay, so just hold it down, and it takes a little bit longer for the mantle to sort of kick in. In this mod. There we go. And then this is a little bit more difficult to return. You found four health potions, six to go. So you can return it. If you just do this. There you go. So we found four, and that's all the health potions in this area. It says that there's 10. Run and jump to the other side, hold jump and pull yourself up onto the awning near the open window. So I was starting to say, it says that there's 10, but there's actually 11 health potions. I'll show you how to get all of them. Okay, so you got to do a running jump there, and you got to stand a little bit further back to start the jump. Jump into this window. And then I want to say thank you to the Master Foundry, his channel, for showing me that these paintings actually could be picked up. And these are worth 125 each. No. 125 and 175, 300 total. Okay. I don't think this is valuable. No. Okay, take some rope arrows from the quiver on the table. So here is our first weapon pickup. We're going to take one rope arrow. We don't need more than that. Okay, so I'm going to head out here. And going to go over this way. Reach over here. You can grab, you found five health potions, five to go. And this one you should also be able to place back like that. Perfect. It's excellent. We even put it further into the corner than it was, but that's good enough. Okay, let's drop down here. There's nothing up on that balcony, but I think the point is that you're supposed to mantle up there and then walk on the line over to the other side and get the potion that way. There's nothing down here. Look for the wooden beam that sticks out. Shoot a rope arrow into it, jump on the rope, climb up and jump off the rope to detach yourself. Okay, let's do that. There we go. So here, to get the rope, I have actually found that you have to mantle up here. then you can walk over to the other side here. You found 6 health potions, 4 to go. There. Right. Jump onto the rope, stay near its bottom end, tap attack to swing, repeat as the rope goes through this midpoint to make it swing more. Then let go by pressing use, I think, or jump, maybe. Can't remember what it said. You found 7 health potions, 3 more to go. Then jump over the canal on the far swing. Okay, that's what it said. Okay, you can't drop items while hanging from a rope, which is logical. So we got a mantle up here to replace it. Grab the rope again. Drop down. Now we're gonna do this. Run and jump. And then you've gotta be a little bit further down to get the proper swing. And then, and jump. So it's jump, not use. Okay. Go all the way over here. Not only ladders can be climbed, these vines on the wall are strong enough to carry you. Use them as you would a ladder. Okay. There we go. And I think actually... Oh no! I actually forgot... I forgot a health potion. Swim using the same controls as movement. Don't stay underwater too long or you will drown. Crouch gives you neutral buoyancy. Stand. And then something I couldn't read. But there is another healing potion over here that I didn't show you guys. You found 8 healing health potions. 2 to go. There's 1 health potion in the canal as well. 100% remember where it is, but... I know it's there. There it is. You found 9 health potions, 1 to go. Let me see. So I want to try to drop this back. Yeah, good. I didn't know whether you could drop things underwater, but I guess you can. Alright. So we have 1 more health potion to go, but we actually have 2. If we look up here, gotta use a rope arrow here to properly get this one. I'm not sure if this one can be replaced, actually. That was a terrible shot. Congratulations, you found all the hidden health potions. Well, no, we haven't. Because there's one more. Okay. We can actually stand on this one. That makes it easier. Awesome. So we've got to maneuver it so that it is... There we go. The last health potion, the 11th one, is on that windowsill. Right there. Acquired health potion. So that doesn't give you any recognition if you've already taken 10. So that we can replace right away. Okay, now we also want to mantle up this rope. Climb up the rope, rather, not mantle it. Oh, I totally missed it. Oh yeah, I didn't see it. I looked at the wrong thing. I think that we can reach it from... We can definitely reach it from this balcony right here. So if any of you have been watching my ghost videos for Thief 1 and 2, you can probably notice that I'm not very good at this game compared to those. I'm going to try that again. There we go. Good. Crouch in front of the window, and then press and hold space to mantle through the opening. Oh, whoa. I did what it told me to do, but... Oh! Okay. And here is a note. Hello, player. I hope you enjoyed playing the new and improved training mission as much as I did working on it. As a small reward for managing to get up to my little room, I have hidden a small gold statue for you to find, Bikerdude. So this is really a cool area because you can pick up a whole bunch of things. You can pick up all of these books, though they don't really have anything important in them. You can open all the drawers and look at the items inside and manipulate and turn those over if you want to. Well, that really shows the potential of this mod. There's only one valuable item in here. And it's in this chest, but it's locked. And we have to find the key for it. And that's on top of the door frame right here. Here we go. The footlocker key. So this is another trophy or statue worth 150. So we're going to lock the door, and now we got to replace this. And let's see if we can do that properly. So then all you need to do, you can move this along the top here without actually seeing it. There you go. And there it is. Very easy. One of my favorite parts about the dark mod. Now we gotta drop back into the canal. Is there anything in here, maybe? I can't remember having looked in there. Nope. I catch myself admiring the visuals of this mod now and then. The lighting is just beautiful. Okay. Now we gotta get up here. And we gotta shoot a rope arrow into the bigger crate. If you shoot it into the smaller crate, the crate will fall on top of you when you climb it. Okay, you can actually grab the rope as you're mantling up. Alright, good. Caution, elevator out of service. Open up this hatch before you drop down the elevator. Climb down the rope. And then in here, the only thing of value is a bottle of wine. Worth 110. Total 1821. Down here. And then we are through. And we gotta close this gate and rush out to reset everything. And that's it. I don't have any of my potions. I just have 1821 loot. Good. Alright, let's say we're about halfway done right now. So next we're going to go to melee and archery, which is not over here. We've done that, we've done that. Melee and archery is right here. Behind this door you'll find an archery range on the right and a melee training area on the left, or arena. So we're going to go to the... Take some arrows from the quiver on the table and read the book for instructions. So since it says in that note, I'm going to go ahead and do that. I'm going to take one broadhead arrow. I'm going to read the book. Archery. In this target range, you can practice using the bow with broadhead arrows. This type of arrow is mainly used for attacking enemies. You will come across other types in other sections. Hold down the attack button to draw your bow and knock an arrow. After a few seconds, your view will zoom in slightly to simulate the act of aiming. If you hold down the attack button for too long, you will start to get tired and your arm will wobble before finally putting the bow down. The targets are placed at increasing distances to help you learn how far you can shoot an arrow. Try to get a bullseye on a target before moving on to the next. Tip: on distant targets, use the spyglass from the object handling section to see where your shot landed. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to try to get the recognition for a good shot on each of these without going through the gate, of course. So let's try that. Easy shot. That was really a pretty bad shot for that close of a target. So that's something that's a little bit different also from the original Thief games, is the trajectory of the actual arrow. It doesn't follow exactly the same pattern. Let's try this one. Okay. I'm still aiming a little bit too high, I can see. Let's try this one again. Not bad. Okay, I guess I got the recognition for that. Still haven't hit the actual bullseyes, though. Alright. Third one, out of four. it's more difficult. That was way too low. Oh yeah, wow. So once you go from this distance to that distance, that doesn't seem too much of a difference, then you have to aim much, much higher. There's not many times in the game that I will ever need to. Nice shot. Thank you. This is when I try to remember how I was supposed to shoot. Excellent shot. So the most difficult one I get on the first shot. Okay. This really is a beautiful area. I think this probably is my favorite section. Looks very nice. Okay, there are a few more pieces of gold loot in this section, so I'll show you those. First of all, in this barn here, you can move in one of two ways. You can either go through the shutters on the front, or you can go in here. In this bucket, you can find three water arrows. We go into this tower. There is a piece of loot back here. Here is a vase worth 75, total 1896. And up in this tower, you can find two vine arrows. I'm not going to pick those up because I don't need them, but they're there if you want them. And then we have another little special area that we're going to cover. Bonus, see if you can steal the purse from the guard's belt without being caught. Let's see if we can do that. Sure exactly where we should stay for this. Huh. The symbols to the side of the light gem actually crunches together once you go from a standing to a crouching position. I don't think I've ever noticed that before. That's pretty neat. Let's try this one. Actually, I'm gonna... gonna make a real save, just in case we mess up. See, I don't know if this is close enough. Okay, so his purse is on the other side, so we can't actually grab it from this way. So we're probably going to have to wait until he returns. So I'm not pitch black now. I can see from the light dim that I'm not as dark as I could be. And he walked pretty much right on top of me. And he still didn't make a comment. Didn't notice me. So maybe the guards, even though it's on highest awareness...
Fine girl. Fine girl indeed.
Acquired 50 in gold. So 50 gold is this purse worth. Let's follow him a little bit. I was waiting for him to make a comment, because guards in the dark mod makes comments a lot easier when they notice either their belts have been lifted or loot being gone. I don't actually think I'm going to end up counting that as a bust, because that's the whole point of thief, is to steal loot. And obviously someone is bound to notice, so you can't ever avoid people knowing something is missing. You're not supposed to get caught doing it. That's the point. But he didn't make an alert there, so we're good. Okay, now we're going to head down to the melee section. Which, again, I should warn you, I am not very good at. I have a few tips and tricks that will make it a little bit easier. But first, we're going to grab another piece of loot. And it is a bottle. Behind a couple of crates here. Let's see, I want to move that crate over. Worth 110. So you can even move crates around. How is this placed like that? Yeah, that's good enough. Okay, 2056 total. Pick up the sword from the weapon rack and read the book about melee combat before you step into the area. Arena, not area. Let's at least read the book. You're a thief, not a warrior, but sometimes you have to fight. Use your short sword. Press and release attack to do a default right to left slash. Hold parry to block strikes. By default, the best angle is used. You need only to time from the enemy's backswing. Practice a few swings. Those two controls are the basis of all your melee. You can strike from different angles if you are moving the mouse in these directions when you hit attack. Thrust forward, overhead swing back, left slash left or none. Right slash right. The mouse must be in motion when you press attack, else you get the default left slash. So that's when you actually attack yourself. For a greater challenge, you may wish to set in the dark mod menu settings controls melee auto parry disabled, which I have done. You can also invert mouse moves in that menu. Now you must not only time parries from the black swing, but also use different angles as follows. You can block from different angles if you are moving the mouse in these directions when you hit parry. Block overhead, forward. Block thrust, back. Block left slash, left or none. Block right slash, right. The mouse must be in motion when you press parry, or you get default block left slash. When you block an attack or harm your enemy, he may be temporarily flat-footed. He can still attack and defend, but will not chase you if you run. This only lasts 1 or 2 seconds, and yet it can sometimes be enough time to allow you to outrun him. But the enemy can parry your blade too, and more easily if you keep using the same method. So vary your attacks. Damage depends on where you hit. Striking the head does more than striking limbs. The sword cannot pierce plate armor. Even chainmail or leather armor gives your opponent some protection. Apart from blocking, you should also practice moving about to dodge blows. One tip, try to counterattack immediately after your foe misses or is blocked. Okay, there's something that's cut away there. In this room, you can now practice what you have just read against real enemies. Draw your sword, step into the arena, and prepare to do battle. Do not fear. If you lose your life, then you will be revived to try that round again. There are 7 rounds of ever-increasing difficulty altogether, with up to 3 assailants at once. If you succeed in improving your fighting skills, then you will be ready to protect yourself in real missions. Dark mod games are mainly designed for stealth. The best protection is usually to not get detected in the first place, but at least now you can be ready if you are. Good luck. Okay. So I will show you just a couple of things on one enemy. I will not go through all 7 modes. If I tried to do that, I would be here all day. That's how bad I am. But then again, I never really use combat when I play these games. So the best thing I have found to do is to make your opponent stand still. If he keeps running after you, it's very, very difficult to dodge and put in any counterattacks. But once he stops, then things become a lot easier. Then you can maneuver around and you can block a lot more efficiently and you can time your blows.
Hey, you over there! Don't move! One.
So there you go, that's how bad I am.
That's it! You've had it now! Here. Die, you scared yet! Hey-yah.
Wow.
I'll teach you to mess with me.
Wow. I don't really know how I can make them stop, but usually it's better to be quick here to just get it done with than anything else.
I'll teach you to mess with me.
Yeah, I don't even know if I'm going to bother continuing with this because it's not working. But if you get your opponent to stop, you can sort of lurk in on him, then go back, and once he swings, you can go ahead and swing right away. Or if you manage to block in a certain direction, as I'm doing now, then you can try to hit him right away after you block. So sort of block and then hit. And hits to the, or blows to the head usually gives more damage than blows to the body. So anyway, I didn't mean to pick up my sword, I meant to reload so I didn't have to, but anyway. But there are 2 pieces of loot up on the 2nd floor here, and the only way we can get there is by way of a rope arrow into one of the poles. So I'm not counting, since this is just a practice area, I'm not counting the fact that they see me as a ghost bust, because this is explicitly given in the instructions here.
What? That's it. You're getting it now. Hey, I've got him cornered here.
There we go. If you're up here, they actually start, some of them at least, start throwing rocks at you. Yeah. That's what he's doing right now. They see you.
Well, it's not going to end well. You can never resist a new pretty face.
Okay. So up here, I have found one goblet worth 15. And then this guy has a purse worth 50.
I'll teach you to mess with me. You think what? Where did he go? Come on out! Uh-oh, somebody's been messing around. Drop that weapon! Don't move! Hey,
I got hit there. I don't want to get hit at all.
He's been messing around. I'll teach you to mess with me.
There. Now I left the area without getting hit. So there we have it. 2 pieces of loot, 21-21 total. I've looked around up there for more, but I haven't found any. So again, if you know of any, please let me know. If you're looking for ways on how to deal with combat situations better, there are several other videos out there that show that. There's one video where... Oh, we're not going in here. There's one video where a guy goes through all 7 stages in like 2-3 minutes. That I would never be able to do, so that's why I'm a stealther. Next, we're going to go to objects and handling. And that's over here. Here you will learn to use various objects you may find in the dark mod. Okay, so when we pick up this book, we're actually going to get it in our inventory. Object handling. In the dark mod, this is much more sophisticated than previous stealth games. You can interact with anything in your environment that highlights when you look at it. Press the frog key. Some of these objects will perform an action, doors, or go immediately into your inventory keys. But most will simply be held out in front of you, chairs, candles. Heavy objects lag behind if you turn quickly while holding them. You can throw held objects by holding the attack key, then releasing. You can drop them with the frog key or drop key. Held objects can be rotated by holding the manipulate key and moving the mouse around. Furthermore, by using the next or previous weapons keys, you can push an object away or pull it closer. Banging a carried object into a surface will make a noise that could alert guards and could even knock it from your grasp, so be careful. It takes a bit of practice to avoid bashing things around like a drunken soldier, but before you know it, you'll be looking under hats, replacing chairs, and stacking crates with ease. Many inventory objects like this book can be dropped into your hands with the drop key, where you can handle them like any other held object. The use key puts them back in your inventory. Okay. So let me see. So I want to move this object so that I can... Whoa. So I have trouble now getting it back to exactly where I want it. There. Oh. Now it's the other way around. There. So I managed to place it back pretty much the way it was lying to begin with. So I'm sure that some authors will really utilize this object manipulation for cool effects in games or in missions. I hope so, at least. So make sure that you learn how to do that properly. Many objects in the dark mod can be manipulated. When an object highlights, frob it to interact with it. It might be an obstacle, junk, or perhaps something valuable. So here we have a painting worth 125. And then the readable gave a hint to this. You pick this hat up. There are 2 rings underneath worth 40 and 40. Place this hat back. Then on this crate you have a gold plate worth 35. You have a bracelet worth 85. You have a bottle worth 110. You have 2 vases worth 75 each. And you have some kind of gear statue, gear trophy, worth 80. You have on this table 5 stacks of silver coins. 2, 3, 4, 5, worth 50 total. You have 2 single coins. And... you have nothing else, but you have a couple more pieces of loot in here. No, 1 more piece of loot. I have not found any other item in here that is actually inventory items, like food, for example, in the Thief games. You cannot pick up and eat, at least not the ones that I've found. But in this footlocker, which I think you have to pick open... Oh, yay, you're thinking. He gets to go at this again. Okay, that was just 1 tumbler. Here is a trophy. No, a statue worth 175. There's no way, as far as I know, to relock this because there isn't a key for it. You will find many useful tools available to you in the Dark mod. Here is but a small sample. So here you have a flash bomb, you have a compass, you have a spyglass, and you have a health potion, which we have met already, and then you have a lantern. So I'm going to show you a little bit about some of these. The compass is very easy, of course, and it's a pretty cool compass. Red shows the north. it functions in the same way as a normal compass would. The spyglass, if you use that, you can zoom with the mouse wheel in or out to zoom in or out on certain areas. It's pretty cool. It's much easier, I would say, and quicker than it is when Garrett uses his mechanical eye in Thief. And then you have your lantern that you can also use if you have it in your inventory, and then just click use or interact. Then you will light up the area around you. Obviously, you'll be seen by anybody at that point. And then we have a little mini game right here where you can use or manipulate items to try to get this candlestick out of this cage. That is not too difficult, but you can either walk back or forth, or you can use this manipulation like that, lower it, move this through here, back up again, and then settle it down like there. I'm not going to pick up any of those items because I don't need them, and you're not supposed to pick up anything you don't need. So technically I wasn't supposed to pick up the sword, but I used it to show you guys, so. And you were supposed to pick it up following the objectives. And that's why you even could pick these up if you wanted to, because the instructions told you to. Okay, one more piece of loot in this section, and that is this trophy. You can drop held objects with Frob or the drop key. You can throw them by holding and releasing attack. Try to get the vase from the top of this column. So I like to use one of the smaller rocks here for that purpose. Okay. Not sure where that rock went. Okay, I'm going to reload so that I can actually find that rock again. Okay, so this trophy or vase, it looks like a trophy to me, worth 250 gold. Total 3263. In this section, there's no loot, but there's one thing I want to show you. You can hold a candle and press use to pinch it out. Torches and other lights can be lit with a flame. Try to light all of the sources in this room. I'm not going to do that, but that's something that you guys can do. There's nothing to pick up or no reward if you do. I haven't found anything, at least. But it teaches you to manipulate items. You can light all of these, I believe. You can light the torches, even, that are hanging around the room. And you can light these, or this long candle. I don't think you can light the one that's tipped over. And there's nothing of value in here. But there's one thing. I don't know if it's a secret or what it is. I guess it is. That you can find up here. This dripping goo on the wall should maybe be a hint. Thank you. Yeah. There's a gas arrow. A gas arrow you cannot find anywhere else in the mission, and it works just like a normal gas arrow does in Thief. It can knock people out. I don't know if it can put out torches, but let's try. Yes, it can. That's pretty cool. So just like in Thief, you can use both gas arrows and water arrows to put out torches. But I'm going to reload because I don't need that gas arrow. Okay. So let's leave this area. We only have one area left to go, but that's one of the more complicated areas to cover. Oh! What on earth happened to this book? I have a little trouble figuring out the dimensions here. I want to try to... get it as right as I can here. Problem is that once you drop it and you pick it up again, it goes into your inventory. Let's see if I can do something with this. There, I think that's pretty good. I don't know if you can actually put it directly against the plate, but who knows? Who cares, really? Okay. So let's make another real save. And then head into the stealth and shadows section. Go out this door and walk over to the nearby builder's warehouse to practice your stealth techniques. You may need to get over obstacles learned in the other sections first. Let's see. Caution, use your quick save key often, see settings. So if you make a mistake, you can retry that section quickly. What I'm gonna do. Being a good thief means not getting caught, and that means being unseen and unheard. At the bottom of your screen is the light gem. The brighter it is, the more visible you are to nearby guards. Light is your enemy. Standing in the light, moving, or holding bulky weapons will all make you more visible. Crouching and staying in shadows makes you less visible. The faster you move, the louder you are. You will usually want to crouch or creep when guards are around. Save running for when you are caught. Pay attention to what you're walking on. Soft surfaces like grass or rugs absorbs most of the noise of your footsteps, while smooth marble, ceramic tiles, and metal will make them even louder. Even if they don't see or hear you, guards can still become suspicious by evidence that you leave. Bodies, bloodstains, or suspicious weapons lying around will alert guards. Hide bodies in shadows and use water arrows to wash away blood. Guards might also notice if any important things are missing or if too many lights are extinguished mysteriously. Luckily, you have an arsenal of tricks to help keep you safe. Water arrows can put out flames and wash away blood. Moss arrows can be used to coat loud surfaces so that they're nearly silent. You can use your lean left or right keys to stay in the shadows while looking around corners to check for guards. Take it slow and keep your wits about you, and you'll be fine. Sounds good. All right, so let's try this. Careful! Up ahead is a noisy metal floor, but the guard is distracted by his paperwork. If you're quiet enough, you may sneak right by him unnoticed. Okay, let's see if we can do that. Remember, some surfaces are more noisy to cross than others. Press crouch and then creep to slowly move across the metal flooring. So, moving on metal is obviously very, very noisy. So now I'm crouching and creeping. And I'm walking forward. Let's see if we can actually get to read the two notes. Oops. There are two notes. So that was an alert. So he actually heard me there. Yes, we heard that as well. I'm not sure if it's possible to... I think last time I actually knocked him out after I have gotten the blackjack. Well, do I have a blackjack? No, I do not. Yeah, so he sees me. So, I think you might need either a gas arrow or... or the blackjack in order to read those two notes. I will, however, go back and show you guys what those notes say, because we will get a blackjack in not too long. Just to be complete. Huh. I don't really know why he alerted there, because I didn't.
It is a rat or other vermin.
So that was the first alert. So I saw him turn his head there. I'm not sure whether that was because I made a noise when I stepped over here, or if it's just movement. Yeah, it looks like it's just random movements. So it's strange. I don't know why he alerted there in the first place, because I didn't make any noise. I creep crouched all the way. He has his back turned. But I guess some guards, even though they're turning away from you, that if you stay behind them for a long period of time, that they will see you. Maybe they cranked up the sensitivity of that guy too. I'm not sure. So at least we managed to do that without. You can lean carefully around corners while still in shadow to get an idea of what lies ahead. Then wait for the right moment and make your move. Here. There are two guards in this area. One is patrolling and partially stationed inside that window that you see. Let's actually go ahead and make... Oh no, we made a real save not long ago. This warehouse has two guards. Get to the rusty door diagonal to this entry. Hide behind obstacles or in shadow. Don't make a noise. Crouching is quiet and makes you less visible. Okay. There's nothing in that guard post room there. But we want to follow this guard. You might be able to avoid being seen if you stay low. That's only if the guard is in there. You can actually sneak past that window. There's nothing that I've found of value in this warehouse except for in one chest, and that's our last piece of loot. There's another guard around the corner. Lean around to see where he is. There he is. So he is turning around. So like now he's actually facing away from us.
My strength have come from the Almighty Builder.
And now he turned around. We got to be a little bit careful with him. So I want to creep up to the window here and make sure he doesn't see me. Bonus. A locked chest might have something valuable inside. Looks like the key is on the shelf. Wait until the guard's back is turned and grab the room key off his belt. So there's a key inside this room and we need his key to open the door to that room. So I have found that if you stand right here, crouched, he cannot see you. If you move on top of that pallet, he will see you. Even if he's... Yeah, if he's facing out. So now he's not facing in. Grab the key. Guard post key. That's all we need for now. So that will open the room... the door to his room. Of course, that key we have to return, and that is the big deal here. That is difficult. Because since we took it off his belt, we actually have to return it to the floor in there, and we still have to lock this door if we want the loot. And of course I want the loot. I'm a thief, what can I say? Wait, there's a guard just around the corner. Listen and watch until he turns. You must take the key from his belt to unlock the door beyond him. So that's a guard that will... come up and turn around over here. Let's wait for him to turn around.
The Lord thy God shall not forsake thee, nor thy works.
Right. On this shelf... Oh, he turned around that quickly. Okay. He has a random... station time facing either direction here. We don't want to get in view of that light. On the shelf... over here.
Lord Builder, bless us.
Okay, so he gave a comment there. We want to sneak in pretty quickly. So I'm still getting used to the... to the alert levels here. On the save like that. I'm gonna wait until he is turning around.
Builder, bless our hands and our tools, that we may do great works in thy name. Amen.
So he didn't see me, even if he was turned this way. Now, for some reason. So notice that I snatched the old chest key from that shelf. We, of course, have to replace that too. I don't like that doors are automatically closing. That is not something I like. That I wish that the makers of this mod would have as an option in the settings, rather. There's also a moss arrow on the shelf there. But that, of course, I don't need. First job, of course, is to open this chest once this guy passes. And there is another vase worth 250. And I lock this chest. Now comes the big problem, or problems, plural. We have to first return that old chest key. That isn't too difficult. That wasn't me, although it sounded maybe like it could have been me. It was the guard that was coughing and sneezing. So this is the tricky area. Yeah, okay, so he sees me if I stand. Very important to crouch here.
My strength hath come from the Almighty Builder.
So it seems like guards really pick up on your movements a lot more when you are not crouched. Seems like that is more important in this game rather than your light gem. And then you want to lock this door. Still haven't gotten a single alert from that guy. It's good. And now comes the biggest problem. We have to actually return the guard post key. And of course, that has to be returned following supreme rules on the inside of the window, right by his feet. How do we do that? So that he sees. That little elevation there.
Do not.
He sees. So we cannot stand on that. Oh no, I didn't save it after that. Really? He doesn't see me? That is the oddest thing I've ever seen.
None would dare challenge the might of the Builder's Church.
He saw me when I was standing up here, but he didn't see me when I was standing in there. That's strange. Okay. Well, I'll take it. No alerts so far. What?
Something. My strength hath come from the Almighty Builder.
He doesn't see me here. I don't know why my light gem is flickering. Not sure. Anyway. What you have to do is first manipulate the key so that it's lying sort of flat.
The Master Builder doth see all.
Like that. Then you should use the mouse wheel to get it as far away from you as possible. Then I would go around like without touching him. Then if the key touches anything, then it will...
Some two arms!
Okay, so I gotta wait for that guy to pass. But you basically have to have your key out like this, then stand up once you are sure that the guard is facing away and this guard is not looking at you.
Verily.
So the guard doesn't see the key floating in front of him. That's good. Now he turned around. So now I touched his head with the key and he looked up at it. That was quite realistic. Oh, I don't want to touch the guard with the key.
The Master Builder doth see all.
But I do want to go down like that. Sort of lower it.
A noise.
I didn't drop it there. I actually lowered it too far, so it actually touched the ground on its own.
Doth see all.
I don't want that. There. I don't have it anymore in my inventory now. I left it on the ground. Even though I couldn't see it, you can actually manipulate the object behind walls. That's a little bit of an engine exploitation, maybe, but that's the same way as you can do
Lord
lock blocking and stuff like that of doors and Thief, so I think I'm good there.
Great works in thy name.
So there we go. That is all the loot in the mission. And we've returned the keys that required us to take, that we required to take that loot with. So I'm going to go ahead and make a real save here. Call that done. Because we are practically done here. But I'm going to take you through the rest of this stealth section. Here. I think we can take his key from here. I'm not sure, but I think so. Yes, we can. Hope we can stay here undetected. Not sure. Yeah. He walks away then, we can use the key on this door.
The Lord thy God shall not forsake thee, nor thy words.
This guard will hear you if you step on the tile floor. Go through the partially door behind you, where you'll find moss arrows and a blackjack. Read the book on the table for instructions. So we locked the door now. We have not returned the key yet, but I will explain why I'm not going to return the key yet for you a little bit later. In this room right here. Don't think there's anything of value. Let me just check. No. Don't think there is here. But we have the blackjack, which we're going to pick up. And we have moss arrows. I'm going to pick up 2 moss arrows. That was instructed in the note. Maintaining stealth requires thought and timing. Ahead is a passage with a guard at the end. Take some moss arrows and shoot them at the noisy tile floor. When the guard's back is turned, walk over the moss and swing your blackjack so that you hit the back of his head. Don't get too close or you'll bump into him and he'll attack. Be sure to quick save beforehand so you can try again if necessary. Leaving bodies lying around will alert other guards that there is trouble. You can drag bodies into the shadows by frobbing them and then moving your mouse around. You can carry the body by hitting use while you are dragging it. Hit use again to drop it. Each time you drop a body, it alternates between landing on its back or stomach. This makes it easier to check the body for valuables. Be sure to hide the guard's body before opening the locked door at the end of the hall. Okay, so this book now gave us 3 instructions. 1, moss the floor. 2, blackjack the guard. And 3, hide the body. So those 3 things we are allowed to do now. Which is what I'm going to do. And again, I haven't forgotten about the hall key. I'll explain that a little bit. Okay. First, I will shoot a moss arrow right here. He is walking back the next time. I will shoot another one.
The Lord Builder hath said, all work is holy in my sight.
There. Now we should have enough moss so that we can walk down that hallway without getting heard. Now he has a key. Now just for the sake of trying to do it, I want to try to grab his key off his belt before I knock him out. Let's see if we actually can do that.
Who would dare it? All is quiet now.
So that was a first alert. Okay, I just got to learn those first alerts a little bit.
Doth something stir?
No, okay, that he saw. All right. Strange to me that the other guard earlier didn't see me standing there in bright light right before him.
Mighty Builder doth watch over those who toil in his name. Doth something stir?
Okay, so he heard me. So he gave a first alert before I blackjacked him. That's not allowed.
Mighty Builder doth watch over those who toil in his name. Tis something.
Yeah, because when you bump into them from behind, you actually alert them, which is, you know, makes sense.
Doth watch over those who toil in his name.
I have managed to do this before.
Mighty Builder doth watch over those who toil in his name. What?
No.
Almighty Builder doth watch over those who toil in his name. Tis.
Okay, you can't run even on moss. So we have to walk up there.
Doth watch over those who toil in his name.
Good. So if you crouch down, then you can grab the key without him giving a first alert. Good. So that was the tiled passage key. That's the key for that door. Now this key we actually can't drop. I don't know why, but we can't do it, so we can't return it either. So you can do that and drag it, and then if you press the use key, you can actually grab the entire body. Then move it. You'll need to hide the unconscious guard. Find a dark corner to dump the body so it won't be found by another guard. So that's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to dump it right here. Like that. That's good enough. There's nothing else of value in this room, at least not that I've found. So let's head down here. So again, the use of two moss arrows, the blackjacking, and the moving of the guard are all allowed, because it's explicitly instructed in the... If you can't open this door, visually check the body of the guard you just knocked out for a key. Alright, well, we can open the door. Few shadows in the next area. Take a few water arrows and read the note. Water arrows. Take a few water arrows. The area is well lit by that torch. Time to change that. When firing water arrows, your aim should be to shower the target with water. A direct hit on the torch might not extinguish it, but a shower from above surely will. Slip into the corner next to the shelf once the torch is out and grab the flash bombs. Okay, so let's grab one water arrow. That's all we need here. Okay, water arrow. So we gotta shoot it above the torch. There. Now it should be dark. I don't think this guard around the corner here comments on the torch. Okay, I thought that was the chest on the other side. Flash bombs. Take the flash bombs on the shelf. Make sure they are selected in your inventory. When the guard is looking in your direction, tap use to let the bomb fall at your feet. As long as you're looking straight ahead, you will not be blinded, but the guard will be unable to see for several seconds. Quickly run past him and crouch through the hole in the wall to the left of the door. You can also throw a flash bomb by holding down use before releasing it, but make sure you're not looking at the point of impact or you'll be blinded too. You can also drop a flash bomb while fleeing from an enemy, and as you're facing away from point of impact, you won't be blinded, but your pursuer will. Okay, so I'm going to grab one flash bomb right here. Now, I'm going to try to use the flash bomb and not get any other alerts than just the flash bomb. So I don't want him to hear me or see me, in addition to using the flash bomb. So I want to see how close I can get here without getting an alert.
Does something move?
Okay, so that we can't go that close.
I cannot see.
Okay, I don't know how long he will be blinded for.
I cannot see.
Thank you.
instrument of darkness shall keep thee safe.
Okay. I'm thinking that maybe I can mantle up on that barrel on the left there.
What? I cannot see. Thou art wise to fear me.
Yeah, I might be able to do that. I think that's safer. Because it's quicker.
What? I cannot see.
Okay, he sees me partly on top of there. Maybe I can just head for the opening. I just wanted to test this out a little bit. I didn't test this out too much last time.
Tis something.
Okay, he sees me after a little while, after I stand up.
I cannot see.
Neither can I. Okay.
I shall smite thee down in the...
Oh, I probably threw it behind him, actually.
I cannot see. Thou art wise to fear me.
So he definitely did not see me. But I'm unsure whether he heard me. I don't think he did. So I'll say that this is okay for Supreme.
Thou art wise to fear me.
He walked straight forward, which proves that he didn't think anything was to this side. Okay. There is no way to sneak past the final guard. You must distract him so you can escape. Read the instructions on the shelf. Diversions. Take the key and noisemaker arrows. Open the double doors. Go out carefully and crouch behind the big crate. Then shoot a noisemaker arrow far inside this room, near the shelves.
Thou cannot hide from me.
The guard should investigate, so put away your bow. Weapons make you more visible, and stay crouched and hidden. An alerted guard is almost sure to see you close up, even in shadow. While he's gone, use the exit key on the far door and escape. He's still looking for me. So, this is the exit key, and we need one more noisemaker arrow here. Should open the double doors.
No instrument of darkness shall keep thee safe.
And then I'm gonna move in behind this crate. There we go. Now we want to use that noisemaker arrow and shoot it far inside this room right here.
Cease thy hiding and come forth where I might see thee. I am a true servant of the Builder's Church. Thou
shalt search the shadows until I find thee.
Okay, so now I close the door, and I lock this door. However, and I've done everything that the instructions told me to, so all that should be okay for Supreme. However, I still have the exit key, and the exit key can be dropped, as you see. So, how do we return that key while still locking the door? That is the big question. Well, In my mind, there are three possible options here. One is that since you can't lock block doors, there is no way to return many of the keys that you're going to end up using to relock doors. So many of the keys you're going to be stuck with at the end of the mission when this kind of a situation arises. So maybe for the dark mod rules, there should be an amendment saying that if you can't get back into the area after you've locked the door, then you can leave it in the nearest logical place, which would be at, you know, at the foot of this door or something. However, that is really the last option out of the three in this mission, because we can actually go through the entire stealth area again and then place the exit key and then head back again backwards, so to speak. Or the third option is simply to avoid the whole last section of this area and simply load the save that I made after I took the loot and be good with that. So I'm going to do both. You know, in case one of them is good and the other is not. So we have to now head through part of this section again. Actually, I just thought of something. To go through the entire area again, we're going to need the flash bomb, the second one on the shelf, but then we're going to have to go back and we need a third flash bomb. So I have to go pick up the one. Actually, let's go ahead and make a real save here. There. We're going to have to go pick up the flash bomb in the objects and handling area. So we're going to end up using... this book seems to shift position, even though it's not supposed to. Yeah. So we're going to end up using three flash bombs, but those instructions tell us to do that. I guess they only tell you to use one, so if you feel that's a bust, to use the other two. I can understand, which is why I'm also just going to reload eventually, but I'm going to show you how to do that. If you want to go through the entire section, you feel that's the way to complete the mission, which I understand as well. I'm going to show you how to... Well, we're going to blackjack it, not show you how, but I'm going to read those two. The letters. There we go. Evening shift report, Jarvis. No visitors. Evening shift report, Jarvis. No visitors. Oh, unless I doth include the large rat I did see skitter by. Evening shift report, Jarvis. Still no visitors. Evening shift report, Jarvis. No bloody visitors. Builder be blessed. But I do grow weary of being treated like an absent-minded fool by Malleus. Mayhap he shouldst attend this post for a few hours and test his own attentiveness. Oh. Brother Jarvis, I have received a report that once again thy watch duties have been neglected. I shall warn thee but once more before making thy transgressions known to the bishop. Thy duty is to watch the very house of the master builder. Wouldst thee not carry the task with proper reverence? 'Tis not a complicated order, brother. See that thou dost not fall victim to thine inattentiveness again, brother Malleus. Interesting. There are a lot of cool side quests and tidbits of information here in this mission that I really appreciate. I think the team, the Dark Mod team, has done a good job on this little tutorial. Okay, so now we have to head through this area again, and that fits well because this guy's leaving.
Doth something stir?
Oh yeah, I was too fast there.
Body food, for the hand's work, for the mind prayer, righteous need naught else.
So now, of course, we already have his key, so all we need to do is dodge him. And we're going to end up coming back this way in order to replace the exit key properly. So then I'm going to return the hall key to this hallway, probably at the end over there by the hammer. So if you think this is a little bit tedious to do this different ways... Yeah, okay, he saw me or heard me something. So what I was starting to say, if you think this seems a little bit tedious, I'm doing this also to experiment a little bit with the ghost mode in the Dark Mod. I'm still not 100% sure of how I'm going to treat it. So that's why I'm doing this ending sort of in two ways. And of course the biggest problem is the exit key return. Here, of course, we can just run by.
These lights try my patience. The Lord Builder knows I have searched well and found nothing.
Okay, so now he finally settled down. It took that long for him to settle down. Wow. We have to be so careful here. So that proves that if you want to use a flash bomb to get through an area without actually blackjacking somebody, you got to be super careful about going back to that area later. So we got to have both flash bombs right now. So now I of course have to head through. Place the key, wait for him to settle down, and then use another flash bomb. Or I might actually be able to use a flash bomb.
What? I cannot see! Lord Builder, bless my hands and my tools.
that I might do great works in thy name and for thy glory. I shall search the shadows until I find thee. I shall find thee soon enough. A noise?
Oh, that door was open. I didn't know that. Okay. I did close it last time, so he forgot to close it.
I cannot see.
Oh, that was the wrong button. Oh, you can replace flash bombs, interesting, without actually using them. So you can drop them without using them. That is also interesting. I'm learning things as I go here.
With hand, heart, and...
So that landed behind him.
I cannot see. Wise to fear me. I shall find thee soon enough.
Good, made no noise there.
Shall find thee soon enough.
I maybe shouldn't have locked the tiled passage door, because now I have to actually unlock that. If he's on my tail, that might be a little bit difficult to handle. But
no instrument of
we'll
darkness
see.
Shall keep thee safe.
This will be interesting to see how long he takes to actually settle down from being hit with a second flash bomb.
I shall search the shadows until I find thee. Thou art wise to fear me.
He's just standing over there. He needs to return to his post to be completely settled down.
The Lord Builder knows I have searched well and found none.
Okay. Then it was just the fact that we were so far away from his patrol that the engine probably shut it off, similar to the original Thief games earlier, because it didn't take more than a couple of...
All work is holy in my sight.
See if we can sneak along this section.
Do I see...
Maybe we can mantle up in a crouching position? I gotta try that. If we can do that, we can actually maintain our stealthy.
Does.
Yeah, we can. We can actually mantle and maintain crouch the entire time. That is also very, very interesting. It's cool. Obviously not something you could ever do in Thief. Alright, so I'm starting to get the feel of what kind of light gem these guys are detecting and which ones they're not. I realize I have to use a flash bomb here.
I cannot see.
I probably shouldn't run there because he would normally hear that.
I cannot see.
Okay, I think I'll just walk normally. Stand up and walk.
I cannot see. I shall search the shadows until I find thee.
Okay, he's not around that corner yet. Good. Good. That's how we do it. All we have left to return is the hall key. The tile passage key we can't drop. Excellent. So we used 3 flash bombs on that guy. It might not be worth it, but those flash bombs are allowed per the instructions to use. What's interesting is if you unlock this door, this guy's patrol route suddenly extends out into this hallway. He did not see that. Hopefully he doesn't hear me dropping the key. If he'll see that key. Huh. That's funny. He'll step on it and kick it, but he won't alert to it. But he will alert to me dropping it and making a clunk. Maybe I should leave it a little bit outside of his patrol route then. So not directly on top of it. That makes sense though, because it would fall away a little bit. So I'd probably leave it. There. Let's see if that'll be close enough. If not, I can pick it up and put it closer. Still not close enough. Well, this is just trial and error right here, so let's try this again. I think this is interesting, though, to find out the mechanics. There. That should be good. Yeah, that should be good. That could have fallen off his belt. That's good enough. Okay, so now...
What was that sound?
Oh, he heard me running. I'm trying to sort of tap the run key as I'm crouching here. See if we can get through this area again. Good. Okay, so that's it. So, like I said, if there was no way to return the key, then I would have probably left it on the outside of the door and deemed that all right, since the dark mod doesn't allow you to lock block doors. This is one way of putting the actual key back, if you want to go through that entire section. And then I'm going to do the second option, which I think is okay in this mission, is to load the save game right after we took the last piece of loot, and simply just head back.
Movement?
Oh. No, now I loaded the wrong mission. Simply skip the remaining parts of the mission, so therefore you also avoid using the flash bombs, for example, or the moss arrows, or the water arrow, or the noisemaker arrow. All of those you avoid by doing this. If that's what you prefer. For this type of a mission, I probably would prefer doing what I just finished, of actually going through the entire section and then going back and replacing things. But this is just in case most of you guys feel that using those two extra flash bombs and alerting that guy a few more times definitely would constitute a bust, even though it's in the instructions. Which I can understand, because the instructions only say for you to do it once, really. Thank you. Okay, so that's it. So to sum it up, for this version, what I did just now, I got 3513 loot, and I used absolutely nothing. However, I did not go through all the areas completely. The stealth and shadows I had to cut short sort of halfway through, because there's no feasible way to return the exit key. The other version I played was when I did go through and return the exit key by going through the stealth and shadows once more, and then return that way. But I had to use a total of 2 moss arrows, 1 water arrow, 3 flash bombs, and 1 noisemaker arrow. But all of those, bar maybe 2 of the flash bombs, were instructed. So those were all good. I also alerted the guy 3 times with a flash bomb, and I blackjacked and moved the body of 1 guard. So in sum, all of that is instructed, except maybe for 2 of the flash bombs. But at least I got to return the key, and I got to relock all the doors. So that's it. I will experiment a little bit more with the dark mod before I do my first real Supreme Ghost mission. And I might even write up a few rules and list those in the video description. And then I can have, hopefully, you guys comment on some of those. But I hope you guys enjoyed that. And I hope you guys liked it so much, if you haven't played this mod before, that you'll go ahead and download it and play it. And looking forward to having you guys back for my upcoming videos. For example, the Black Frog, which I'm going to finish. And other fan missions coming up. So until next time, goodbye for now.